Thank you very much for the introduction. I didn't know what type of audience I would get because it's an open seminar, everybody can register. So I'm sure there is a lot of diversity in this room. You know, some of you are curious maybe about business process management. You know you have business processes. You know you have to manage them and want to get started with a methodical way of doing it. Some of you probably are very mature in business process management and you have models all over the place and you want to know what next you can do. And it is extremely challenging to be able to serve everybody in the equal amount. So I will try to basically put together a presentation that touches on a lot of points in business process management. And I will then leave it to you to stop me where you want to zoom and learn more about a specific topic. So if a topic is boring, just make as if you are sleeping. You don't need any effort for that. And I will realize that I have to go quicker. And when the topic is interesting, you wake up and you watch and maybe you ask a question. And then I will know that that point is something you want to explore. So roughly what I want to talk about today are the objectives of the talk or what is the exit condition today. This afternoon, I will feel we have achieved the objectives if we have inspired those of you who are not systematically thinking about your processes to go back to your companies and think processes. What are my processes? Where are my processes? Who is doing my processes? And what can I do to improve them, to improve the work that is being done in my business processes? And if you get some two or three ideas, that's enough, of things you can go and do tomorrow or next week or just a week after. November doesn't work, you will have forgotten everything by then. So something you can do next week, or you can start next week, that will be aimed at improving some process in your organization. And that's the third question I would like you to go out of this room with an idea, with an answer, is like, what processes will I try to improve first in my organization? Right, so three things. If we manage to come back at 4 o'clock and you think you have something out of these 3 points, I think we are all happy. And if not, well, you can sleep, you know, 3 day out of work. It seems formidable. That's why we chose Thursday. It's proven that that's the most difficult working day, actually. Friday is not that difficult because you're thinking this weekend, right? And Monday morning is a bit difficult, but then it gets better. But Thursday is very hard because you still have to do one more day and you're already tired of the current week and you are very stressed because you haven't done this week what you were planning to do this week. Yeah, and you are only one day away of finishing the week. So everything comes together on Thursday. So the great thing is that if you don't get these 3 points, at least you will go through your Thursday without too much hassle. The course has 3 parts, each of them 1.5 hours, right? The first part is like a quick introduction on why you should think in terms of business process management and an overview of what is business process management and what are the activities involved in business process management, how to do business process management, what to do first. Part two, then I zoom into 2 things. Building what we call a business process architecture, and maybe some of your organization, some of you already have a business process architecture, so that's when you can sleep. And how to take that architecture and start prioritizing your process and say, these are the processes I'm going to focus on. And then I'm going to talk about modeling your processes, and modeling your process could take like a full day. I'm just going to say like that the minimum thing you need to start modeling your business processes. And then this is the morning, so one and a half hours break, coffee break, 1.5 hours lunch break, and we'll have some catering, and 1.5 hours in the afternoon, and then there you are. You're off. The talk is based on a book that we have recently written with some colleagues in Australia, Austria, and Netherlands, called Fundamentals of Business Process Management, and I'm going to cover 4 chapters out of them. The first 3 chapters is actually available online. And even the rest, we have a website called fundamentals-of-bpn.org. Don't blame me for the name. We have already been blamed many times. Actually, if you type on Google, fundamentals of BPN is the first link. right? And in there, we have a slides and video recording for basically every chapter of the book, introduction to BPM, slides, video recording, the Tartu version, the Australia version, and for every chapter in the book, identification, basic modeling, advanced modeling. As you can see, advanced modeling gets very, very long. We have slides and video recording. So if there is one topic today that you think you want to go deeper into it, you know, you can, you know, watch these things on your way back home. And also, today's slides, the slides I am using are already available. You just type SlideShare Marlon Dumas and you'll get to my page on SlideShare. And there are the slides of this talk and the slides of many other talks I have given before. And if you type on Google YouTube my name, Marlon Dumas, you get to my YouTube channel. And probably tomorrow I will upload the entire recording of what we are listening to today on YouTube. So you can watch it. I know you are going to have a fight with your kids. I have the same fight. I want to watch YouTube. And then my kid comes immediately and wants to watch YouTube too, but different channels, right? Yeah, so... Okay, so let's get started. Okay, so first, what is BPM? So nothing fancy there. It's just a discipline. So there's methods and there are tools to do a number of things with business processes, to design those processes, to analyze them, to execute them, to automate them as well, and to monitor them, and to continuously manage your processes to make sure that they get continuously improved and they don't degrade. And the key question then is not so much what is business process management, is the management of business process, just as project management is the management of projects, right? So project management, business process management, change management. So we understand what that is. The key question is to understand what a business process is. And that sets the scope for what business process can do and what it cannot do. So a business process is a set of activities and decisions that follow a certain event that happens. And that involve people and resources that produce value for the company or for its customers, or ideally for both of them. Right. Every process starts with an event. Something happens, something needs to be done. So the most typical process of them all, and every single company has one, is called the order to cash process. And it's the process that starts when you receive an order, bam, a purchase order, for example, and if you are in services industry, well, that will mean maybe, you know, let's say consultancy industry, that will mean that you have to send some of your consultants or your people to a company, and you have to do timetabling, and then you have to eventually send invoices and monitor payments, and then mark invoices as paid, and so on, and deal with all sorts of complaints. If you are in the retail industry, you know, in the wholesale industry, other companies make you purchase orders, and you have to, you know, pack them at the, check your inventory, schedule the delivery, pack the materials, put them in a truck, send them out to a logistics company, track the delivery, get the invoice, pay the, track the payment of the invoice, send reminders to the customer, and so on. So that's the most typical process that any organization has, and the most important because it's the one that gives revenue, right? So the opposite of order to cash, many people have it too, is you need to purchase things, right? So the opposite of order to cash is called procure to pay, which is, it starts from the moment someone in the company wants to purchase something, right? So I want to buy, a bag of pens, right? Anything. I want to buy a bunch of pens. It could be like anything that you need in your offices or in your production units and so on. And that process goes into getting quotes and selecting a supplier, sending a purchase order, tracking the delivery. Once it is delivered, waiting for an invoice, then crossing that the invoice and the delivery are matching, and then make the payment or else contest the invoice, say this is not the right amount, I will not pay that, etc. So until the moment you pay, right? And there you consider it settled, and that's it. So it always starts from an event and it goes to an event. You receive a purchase order, you get your payment. You want to buy something, you pay for it, right? Insurance companies have something else called claim to settlement. You know, they receive an insurance claim and they have to do a bunch of things, you know, like you do a number of checks. It's a checking machine, you know, until they are satisfied that they have to pay or they do not have to pay, and then they pay or they say, we will not pay. And then if they do not pay, then there's all the dispute resolution that comes with. That is also part of the process. So claim to settlement is another example. It starts because somebody put an insurance claim on the desk of the company. Another company that everybody should have is fault to resolution. Anyone doesn't have a fault to resolution process? You don't have. It means no faults, everything perfect. So fault to resolution starts when a customer puts a customer complaint, right? And all the investigations and gathering of data that have to occur around that customer until negotiating some settlement with the customer, perhaps, until the point your customer considers that the claim has been settled, or at least you consider that the claim has been settled. Internally also, you might have issue to resolution processes, like IT services will have an issue to resolution process that starts from the moment somebody complains of a problem in the computer system to the moment the problem is diagnosed and resolved and everybody's happy about it. So this is the scope. This is what makes something we call it a process, is that it has a clear start and it has a clear end. You execute it a lot of times, it has a clear start, it has a clear end. If it has that, then we can say it's a process. And business process management is about managing those things. Everything that you have a start, a clear start, clear end, and it's being done day after day after day, or month after month after month. Right. Otherwise, we will not call it a business process. It might be something else. You know, there's something else in your system. Not everything really in a company is a business process, and you know, not business process management will not solve all the problems in a company, and it's not meant for that. And it's a mistake to try to apply it to something that is not meant. Right. Any questions about that? About, you have a doubt, like, we have this thing and I do not know if it's a process or not in my company. Okay, let me try to engage you in participating. who does not have an order to cash process? There's nobody from government here. That's great, isn't it?
Actually, I was thinking exactly the same. Yeah.
That you are from government and there's no. Well, in government there is no that, but there is another, the one that I skipped, which is this one. In the government there is always this application to approval, right, type of processes. So they, in a way, the government is not necessarily selling it because the customer does not pay, or if they pay, they just pay a symbolic amount. For example, permitting department, permitting processes, where people apply for a permit to put a flag in the front of that building, right? And to the point where the permit is either granted or is rejected, and if it is rejected, also all the dispute resolution that will come afterwards in case the customer is not happy with the decision. So government agents will have an application to approval process. That includes also you going asking for an ID card or asking for a passport or asking for any other type of document as a citizen towards the government. You are engaged with the government agency in an application to approval processes, which is the closest there is to an order to cash in a government organization.
Do you need to separate concepts of process and project?
Project.
In this case, the process definition is equally applicable to the project concept of project.
Well, there is a process of project management, right? You know, so there is a process of project management, but things that have to do with project management, they are dealt with in a separate discipline, which is project management, right? So But yeah, there is behind a project, there is a process of managing the project from the moment the project is created to the moment it is delivered, you know, like start to delivery type of process around a project, except that it's not something that is typically looked at in business process management. So there is a whole set of other techniques for dealing with that particular process of start to completion of a project, right? Or planning to completion, maybe, of a project. There is an association, Project Management Association, that has produced this Process Management Body of Knowledge, PMBOC, PMBOK, right? I can write it down somewhere here, PMBOK. Process Management Body of Knowledge. It's an entire consortium behind it, and they have, if you look at their reference model for project management, you will see that they in a way, they are describing the best practices for the process of managing projects. Right. So it is that, but they have very specialized techniques. The aim is to produce a project plan that is then executed. The execution of a project plan is just part of the project management, and every project plan is different, right? So you shouldn't see one project as one process, because in the process there is the notion of it is repeated many times, whereas in a project plan it is done specifically for this project. So that makes it a bit different. Right. Any other processes you like that are not mentioned here? No? All the processes you have are mentioned here. Definitely not. Right. Okay, but we'll see many more processes will go on. So what is important to retain of this definition of process, and I'm going to illustrate this for a process, is like, imagine I have a process for a fault resolution, right? It starts with a customer complaining that their washing machine that we sold them 3 days ago is not working, and they call our sort of maintenance or after-sales service call center, which will then figure out what the problem might be and will dispatch a technician, typically a contractor from another company, to go and check that washing machine at the customer's house. The technician will get there and maybe will find that you need to repair it and you need some parts to repair it, and will take the machine out or will go to the parts, to the warehouse where they will pick some spare parts. And then there is the issue of whether the who will pay for it. Is the customer's fault? Is it the constructor's fault? And the warranty issues that go with. And then you get typically an unhappy customer, as usual. So what is very important to retain in a process is that it has a clear start, it has a clear end, and in the ends there are good ones and bad ones, right? So there are good ends and there are bad ends. So I'm refining the notion of a process. Huh? It has a start, it has an end, and in the ends we call them outcomes. Outcome. In the outcomes there are good outcomes and there are bad outcomes. Every process you have, you can see it that way. Here it starts, here it finishes, this is the outcome. There are good ones, there are bad ones. And what we want is to maximize the value of the process. And to define what value means, it will be very different for every process, but we will kind of do exactly the same thing. We will ask, what are the outcomes? What are the outcomes we want? What are the outcomes we don't want? And value is basically delivering the outcomes we want, you know, with the least amount of resources, right? And in a predictable manner, right? Particularly in a predictable time frame. So it's about making, I would say, better, cheaper, faster. Faster, better, cheaper, right? So these three things. Okay, and how do you get started with defining what value is for a given process? which is the first thing to start analyzing that process and to see if it's worth improving. The first thing is to do some sort of rainy day analysis. Yes?
I have one question about this question. That was this is a wonderful procedure. But that is an inventory and there is a dispatch management. Are there also sub-procedures?
Yeah, they are what we call activities.
What's the terms?
Activity.
Activities.
This would be, behind that there's activities, but I have not all named them as activities. I have named them after the department that is involved, which is another aspect of a process that will cross different organizational units. The call center, the service dispatch center, the technician, which is an actor, the warehouse, where I have my parts, and the warranty department. So I will have many different departments.
But the warehouse or inventory is a huge topic. There is a lot of procedures.
There is a lot of processes also on the back, right? Which are not the issue to resolution process, which
is like an umbrella procedure.
You can see it that way, that there is an umbrella procedure, but there's another way of seeing it. It's like there is this process, and then there are other processes. So there is the restocking process behind the warehouse. From the moment you detect that you are low on a given part, or that you are out of stock on a given part, to the moment you resolve that problem. And that is another process. And it is related to this process. The two processes support each other. One process supports the other, but not trying to make it two umbrella, because then we go back to the fact that you have a business and there are lots of things to do there. So, and that's what business process management is trying to do, is trying to cut your business into slices that you can manage better. Right? You can manage each slice, and then the system will hold together.
Still, the procedure will have the owner.
Yeah, the process will have an owner who is the one who is judged after this value that the entire process is being created. Right. The process an owner, and there are different other managers that will be involved, because each of these sections here, the warranties, the warehouse, the service dispatch, the call centers, will also have other managers. So that's characteristic of business process management, is that business process that they will cross different business lines or different departments or in your organization, right? So, and the type of diagram I'm showing here is called the customer visibility. It's a handoff diagram. So I'm not showing what activities are being done in this diagram. I'm showing where does communication occurs, or where is work handed over from one actor to another. The customer gives work to the call center, who gives work to the service dispatch center, who gives work to one particular technician, who gives work to the warehouse, who gives work to the warranty department, who then interacts back from the customer. So I'm just showing the handoffs, and this is a very nice way of picturing your processes before you start doing any modeling. You know, how many handoffs I have in my process? And there is a heuristic that if there are no, like, if there are at least three handoffs, it's a process. If it's just like you, customer going and talking to one person in the organization and resolving the problem on the spot, no handoffs, then business process management will not help you. Right. Okay, so we first thing in a business process is to find what the business process is that you have in your organization. Where does it start? Where does it end? What are the outcomes? What are the positive outcomes, and what are the negative outcomes? The positive outcomes are the ones that are generally easier to determine, right? You want that a positive outcome is one where the customer was happy with the way the case was closed, which means their machine was repaired and what they paid for it or didn't pay for it was exactly what they were expecting. So no problems, everybody's happy, right? And then you go to the negative outcomes, right? And and there you have a whole lot of things to discover. So you are discovering the value of your process through how it can go wrong. And this is kind of very nice initial analysis to do on your business process. Easy, not too easy, but you know, it's like very understandable. What are you doing here? So you will say like the fault was not repaired. That's That's one possible negative outcome. Right? The fault was not repaired, and the customer wasn't happy about it. But then even the fault was repaired, but it was repaired too late. You have problems of time. Or it was repaired and not covered by the warranty. And the customer was not happy about it. It was repaired and it was partly covered by the warranty and the customer was not happy about it. Or it was repaired, but in fact, all that was happening is that the customer had forgotten to plug the machine into the socket, right? So no electricity, so that's why the washing machine was not working, which is also a negative outcome. So the customer is happy, but you are not happy because that created the work that was unnecessary, right? So you start finding all the possible outcomes and always questioning you, like, is this really the only case that can happen, or are there two sub-cases in there? And you say, well, there are two cases. There are cases where it was repaired and it was worth the effort. There are cases where it was repaired, but in fact, we could have avoided that work. So you kind of do a mapping of all the possible mistakes that can happen. So rainy day analysis, we call it. You sit down on a rainy November day with the people and ask them the question, very simple, when was the last day that something was going so wrong you were thinking about resigning and moving to another job? Right. And then people will tell you all sorts of stories. Yeah, I remember that day. And then you can get a lot of information about what goes wrong, right, in the process. And in doing that, you get a list of outcomes, positive outcomes and negative outcomes, and then we are going to define value as maximizing the positive outcomes, minimizing the negative outcomes, with the least amount of resources and in the fastest possible time frames. Right. So the other thing about a process is that it has a start, it has an end, there are outcomes, good outcomes, bad outcomes, and it is. That's not enough to say it's a process. There is another rule, which is like something is not a process if it doesn't have handoffs. You know, if it does not make at least three people mad, that's the heuristics, then it is not a process. Right? But it doesn't work the other way around. You can have three mad people, and that's not a process either. So it's just in that direction, right? It's a condition. It's a necessary condition. It's not a sufficient condition, right? So what we saw in the previous process that there were about five different stakeholders or departments involved in the process, that makes it a process. And what we're going to try to find in business process management is to what extent does the negative outcomes are coming from the handoffs of work? And what can we do to improve those handoffs of work in such a way that we maximize positive outcomes, we minimize negative outcomes. Right, and I think I have already spoken too much, half an hour. Whoa. Right, so I would like you to participate, right? Shout, tell me this is boring, this is useless, etc. Or else, think about your own, one of your processes, you know, the ones that is closer to your heart. Tell me what type of process it is. When does it start? When does it end? Right? Is it an order-to-cash process or a quote-to-order process? Is it a procure-to-pay process, a photo-resolution process? Is it some other type of process that is not necessarily very common? And then tell us... that's great that it went off. It's good timing because it's your turn. And tell us who is the customer, what is the value in the process, and so on. While you start thinking about your favorite process, I'll try to put this one back.
Thank you.
I'm afraid I will have to invoke a photo resolution process right now, so you can ask her, yeah, because it's all completely gone, right? So the project is at home. Okay, so I'm going to write it here. Who is or are the customers of your process? Right. So you think about your process, writing a piece of paper, you know, think about who is the customer, who are the customers, is it the customer inside the company, is the customer outside the company, sometimes it is internal, sometimes external. And what value the process delivers, what makes the person that your customer or the process has, what is that the customer is looking for? Thank you. And who are the key participants in the process?
So is that for external customers and customers who give
yes.
the money?
Aha!
Different products that you sell outside and the products between the departments. You can say so.
Yeah, there are, absolutely. There are internal processes and there are external processes. So a procure-to-pay process is a typical internal process. Warehouse processes, the ones that we think about it, like the backend, they are completely internal processes, right? And then there are external processes, the ones where you have an external customer who is paying. And indeed, sometimes in the external process, there are two different customers. One that is called the customer itself, he's the one who pays. And the one who is called the user is the one who actually uses the outcome. Yeah, right. So indeed. So when we say customer, you can in some cases you can decompose into customer and user, and then you have a dilemma as to who you are creating value. Right? Are you creating value to the user or are you creating value to the customer? Ideally, they are aligned.
Some other stakeholders that have to consider
yeah.
problem, like yeah. Owner of a higher level development process. So if we have this application to approval process, there is some higher level application to approval process following this process. So how to point?
Yeah, you have another. Top level, you have a management process on top of your actual process.
Right.
So yeah. So I'll write it down. So you have an issue that there is, you have an operational process. This is the one you think about, like application to approval. But on top of that, you have a management process. Or a set of management processes that, for example, are producing the guidelines and the regulations for the bottom level process. This process doesn't do work, it just finds problems in this process and produces new guidelines for it. Right? So that's a typical case where you have two processes and they are related. One is giving input to the other, right? So again, that's the good thing about this process, that you start decomposing. You start saying, I have two different things here. I have my application to approval process. Well, given the guidelines I have at a given point in time, this is how I handle an application. And you have another management process on top of it that supports the process that is actually delivering to the customer. This one is delivering to the customer, to the citizen. And this one is delivering to the organization itself. This is your company. Your company. And they are two different processes. They start at different points in time. They finish at different points in time. This is probably much longer spanning process of defining the regulations for a particular, revising regulations for a particular type of permits or applications. And these are more short span processes where you deal with specific cases of a customer.
Because now the process is slicing the actual customer problem in some manageable pieces, and our application is not satisfying the customer directly. It's a sub-product.
So if you have a process where a customer wants something, but you are only doing part of what the customer wants.
Yeah, it seems so.
Yeah. There you have a. Then yes, you seem to have a sub-process of a larger process in which the customer is engaged. And the question then is whether the other parts are inside your same organization or in different organizations.
It's not our problem. We have applications to deliver.
Yeah.
So what to do? How to approach customers? How to provide value? And who? To whom?
Mm-hmm. Do you have a single customer or do you have multiple customers?
Applications to deliver something. And now we want to measure if we are successful in this. So we need to know the customer.
You need to know who the customer is.
Exactly.
That's for sure. And then you need to know what the customer wants. Second question. What that customer wants. When are they happy? Those are going to give you your positive outcomes, and then when they are unhappy, and that will give you the negative outcomes, right? But if you don't have a customer, I'm afraid that it's going to be tough. Yeah. So we are having problems with the customer. Okay.
Another stakeholder that has just been the customer, the management. Another type of stakeholder is sponsor, who is kind of also involved in assessing the value of the outcome. Is it true?
Yeah. I think, but I would like to pitch to you that way. Very often, behind an operational process or a set of operational processes, there is a management process above it. You know, the process of periodically monitoring the performance of that process, you know, and assessing that process, or the process of dealing with specific types of problems that these are occurring in the operational process. And here it's like pure managers involved in this management process, right? The one that is above. Internal managers are involved in there. And that is another process. It has completely different outcomes. The outcome of this process is, let's say, a change in the procedures or it's some other management action points to improve the process. So that's one way of splitting it, because otherwise you have a lot of things that are intermixed and actors that are intermixed. You know, you have whatever the process is, an application process, and then there are, okay, and we have to make these people happy, or these regulators happy, or these managers happy, you know. And it's like you are back to the point where you have a business, and you have to figure out what's going on. So the process is trying to force you to cut it in this direction. There is somebody who wants something to get done and does something, tough, so that you realize, pinch it, I need it, right? And then you have to do a number of things to satisfy that customer, right? And management process have a customer. Yeah? It's a manager. It could be executive managers who want to know what is, you know, what is the status of my process in terms of its performance. And then you map that process separately. You analyze that process separately. You improve that process separately. But if you start mixing them together, I'm not quite sure what process would you get. Yeah.
About these auxiliary services, HR,
financial. Oh, HR is not a process. That's the first thing. HR is a department. It's a function in the organization. In HR, there are processes, right? The recruitment process, which is the process from opening to hiring, right? You know, opening to hiring, where a new position is open, and everything that goes with advertising the position, headhunting. Receiving applications, screening applications, interviewing, getting reference letters, shortlisting people, you know, having two or three rounds of interviews, making a final decision, approaching the person, etc., and up to the point where you sign a contract, right? So that is one process, and it's one process within HR. It's one of the most typical operational process that HR has. And above that, there are management processes. You know, the process of revising the recruitment policies or revising the position opening policies. That's the sort of other processes. So in a way, this process management is giving you a way to take your bigger chunks of business and split them into smaller chunks. Yeah.
You mentioned the situation where my process is a separate organization, independent organization between me and my process and my customer. That's exactly the case for the government, actually, I think. Mm-hmm. Because government does policies, someone develops an application, for example, in my case, and the final customer is pretty clear on the population. So, any suggestions, how do you plan these kind of processes from government levels through independent other institutions, organizations, down to the customer level?
So you kind of have a set of interconnected processes. Yeah. All right, this was not the intention now. Let me see how far away am I from this. Okay, I'm going to make a bit of a jump. Oh.
So if it's too kind of complicated to go out of the context at the moment, we can maybe discuss it later.
Yeah.
Or the
framework
or something?
Yeah, we can. But I think that all the things we are having is a recurrent issue. Well, there are two issues, okay? The first one was raised like sometimes there are two customers, okay? There is the customer. You know, this is the guy with the money, right? And then there is the user, okay? This is the person who wants what you want. So in a order-to-cash process, you can have that situation where there is the customer is the business to which you are selling, and there is the user is the specific person in that organization who asked it for, who triggered your purchase order. So that's one aspect to it, right? So that's kind of easy to identify, and of course you want to make this guy happy, and both of these and this guy happy. So you have two customers here. So the second question you have is, you seem to be having systems where there is a bunch of what I would call operational, I would say day-to-day processes. Operational process. So that could be a permitting application, a permitting process. Application to approvals. Just to say something, maybe there are other things involved in there. There might be many other processes involved. And on top of that, you have a layer of management, which in government will be called policy development. which are typically started by some set of issues or that have been raised by citizens, by different lobbying groups or organizations have raised a set of problems, right, set of issues. So I'll just say issue with capital I to say it's like a big issue, right, in the agenda, to the point of resolution. And resolution, again, with capital R, resolution, issue to potential resolution, right? Actually, it goes a bit further to then implementation. Implementation of the resolution, right? So you have like your everyday today workers on the ground in different agencies having a bunch of these, doing a bunch of these processes where they are getting requests from citizens for different things to the moment they get approved or they are like making tenders or, you know, and so on, right? There can be some tendering process, which is from the point where from need to tender to contract. And so you have a bunch of these processes in different agencies, and you at the top are dealing with big issues that are being raised in these processes, and then you have a separate set of people who are responsible for grabbing these issues, bundling them, analyzing them, consulting different groups, making proposals for new legislation, forwarding these proposals to Parliament, for example, who then comes with a resolution, and then implementing that resolution, communicating it to the different agencies and saying, this is how it's going to be done. And then it will impact on this one. So we have kind of split the system into two layers, right? The management process and the operational process.
Okay, the definition of the layers becomes crucial in this case, right?
Yeah. Okay. And we have multiple processes, and these processes have a relationship. This process here, which is this process of issue to implementation at the policy level, has a relation to, let's say, application to approval, in the sense that it fits that process with guidelines and procedural guidelines, yeah.
And kind of follow-up question in this, how often, in your experience, governments use actually this process management?
In Anglo-Saxon countries, a lot. In Germany, a lot. So in fact, in the US, it has been the case recently that right now, there is a big thing in the U.S. that all government agencies have to make their customer processes transparent. It's a bill that was passed about 3 or 4 months ago, and it's now starting to kick a whole bunch of business process management efforts in government agencies across the U.S. And actually, in the U.S., this is like the third time it has happened in the past 10 years that there has been bills of this sort. And in the U.S., industry analysts are saying that government is taking the lead in business process excellence, not private sector anymore. It's the government. The government makes these bills, and then all federal agencies start doing that, and that makes like to create a compendium of knowledge in this particular in a certain area. In this case, customer processes, customer facing processes, and then the knowledge that is then acquired, then these consultants once all these period of transition in the government goes by, all these consultants go to private sector and start reselling like what I learned there to your company, right? So it's amazing how in the U.S. its governments have become so big users of BPM that now they it's going from government to private sector, whereas traditionally you have been the other way around. Huh? Manufacturing companies are at the forefront of processes, right? And what they learn, you know, goes into five, you know, different levels, and then ends up in government, right? So, and in Germany, it's like everybody, right? It's like, yeah.
I think I'm quite confused about this term process. What
process.
Mean, yes. Does it mean that it's theoretical? Yeah, it's a set of activities.
Yeah.
Or it's a real life skills are implemented. Because probably if you have two departments and one procurement procedure, two different departments they will fulfill it slightly differently. It's two procedures or one procedure or different variants.
Yeah, so you bring another topic. You guys are much more advanced. So you bring another topic is that every process almost has, in any reasonably large organization, has variants, right? Every variant typically has an owner, and that is a problem. Yeah, that is what determines the boundaries of the variant. Generally, is the owner. If it's like the same owner for two different variants, you can start managing them as if they were the same, but just like the decisions are different. In this one, when we find this, we do it that way, we find that the other way is better. And there are many drivers for variance, so that's an interesting topic. So variant. And there can be because of the products. You offer different products. And for different products, order to cash for different products or services looks completely different in your organization. Even there are different business lines and therefore different managers behind it, different what we call process owners, who manage the different variants of order to cash because you have different products. That's typically the main driver. But it could also be like pretty much the same product, just different customer segments, right? And that's like you sell directly to end users versus you sell to businesses. And the process for selling to one or to the other are different, right? And different process owners. Maybe you have different managers behind your retail and your wholesale activities, right? So different customer segments or markets, right? That's higher level than customer segment. Huh? And that entails different countries, right? So if you are running the same process in different countries, you might be doing it completely different. Order to cash, but completely different. There are other... Then there are some operational reasons for variance, but that's not very important. I think these are the main ones, right? That yours will fall into one of those.
So when you describe the procedures, then you describe the participants and the rules. But in the variance, there are like positions. So.
Yeah, now how do you manage process variance, right? Do you manage them separately, and at some point in time, do you come and manage them together? That is the question. I mean, the typical company will start by managing their variants separately. And at some point in time, because of pressures of economies of scale, consolidation, we'll say, well, we cannot really have continuous sustaining, 10 different versions of our order to cash processes because we are not caring enough. Typically, somebody came with the idea we will build an information system to support all 10 variants. And then you start thinking about, okay, these variants have evolved separately, and now I'm going to try to combine them together, standardize them, we call that standardization, as much as possible, so that I can support them with the same information system behind, whereas typically these are separated. So that is a topic on its own. And then you end up with a problem that different variants have different process models, and you want to come and merge them together to some extent, so that you can then specify the requirements for the information system that will support the multiple variants.
So the process can have the same name, but different content.
Yeah, it could be your lead to quote process, how you get customers, right? Lead to quote, from the customer lead to you giving a quote, or from lead to order, how you get your orders on board. But you have two different products or three different products, and you would do it very differently from each of them. Different managers, different workers, different departments, and each of them with a different set of customers, perhaps. In banking, same processes for institutional customers, private customers, retail customers will be very typical as well. This is a very specialized topic. I can put you in contact with the guy who knows about that particular topic in our group. So in our research group, there is one person, explicitly variant management. And how do you manage different processes like to different variants? Typical in insurance and banking sector, insurances have a headache with that because they have claims, their claims processes. it's like claim to settlement. But there are home insurance claims, there are car insurance claims, motor insurance claims, and all sorts of claims. And they are very different. And then typically an organization, insurance starts doing business, a business process management, and then they will have some processes for their home insurance claims, some process for the car insurance claims, some for the travel insurance claim, liability insurance claim. And at some point in time, they are wondering, should we manage them separately or should we manage them together? Okay, so great. Any other aspects you would like to touch around this thing? So I'm assuming you thought about your process, you thought who the customers are, and what the value that the process delivers, and who are the actors, who participates in the process. Any questions that came to your mind when you did that? Three negative outcomes of your process? There are not. This is great. I mean, when you start asking, when you start doing this, you start wondering, okay, who is the customer here, right? Do I have one customer? Do I have two customers? You know, if I have two customers, what value does it deliver to one customer? What value does it deliver to another one, right? So if you start getting these questions, that means that you kind of have kind of understood what is a process and how to decorticate one process into its components. Okay, so just I guess that many of you are already into BPM, it seems, so I don't need to convince you why we should do BPM, right? You can get reasons from the IT side, you have reasons from the management side. This BPM is interdisciplinary. Different viewpoints.
What is your elevator pitch to the managers?
What is my elevator pitch? Okay, so then it's like, depends, you come from IT, you will say it's effectively, I'm going to prepare, I just don't know which one is there. This is fantastic. Maybe here, right? Right. Is that one? So one is to say, like, very often BPM will be started from we want to automate something. Now we have a problem of time, we have a problem of cost, and we know that our competitors have solved it by introducing this particular ERP system and automating this process in this way, so we are going to do it. So then, you know, you justify BPM from the information technology side, in the sense that saying, yeah, we have to do BPM because we are going to introduce an IT system, and we know that IT does not deliver value by itself, right? At least since 1975. But IT enables change in my business, in my processes, that will then get business value. And that's one easy way to justify it. You know, if there is already a buying, like we're going to do like our competitors and automate into this, well, then we have to do business process management. It's not enough to just buy SAP, right? You have to adapt it to your processes or adapt yourself to their processes or something in between, which means we have to map our processes. And that's how very often BPM starts. In many organizations, started because you are going to buy SAP or Oracle, and now we need to understand what are our processes, what are their processes, and how can we meet somewhere in the middle. So that's one perspective into it. Or if I put it differently, you know, if you are going to automate, make sure you automate something that is already efficient. Do not automate something that is inefficient, because you will just rip off so few benefits of your automation that it would not justify the cost of the automation. Now, you might be more interested in justifying BPM now from the management perspective. So there's no external force. We will buy SAP or we will buy Oracle or stuff like that, or we will implement an information system to automate all these processes. If you do not have that external force, but you still want to do BPM because you think it is important from a management perspective, here's a pitch, right? So every organization, so the first thing starts like this. Every organization, the management level, kind of needs to care about these nine things. Okay. So is there anything there you think is not important? No, right. So I'm approving one side of it. It's all important. Is there anything important that is not there? Management. Great. So I have done the other step, which is to convince you that pretty much this is what is important in management, right? Okay. So this is how BPM can help you to cover all these different aspects which are important for management and that cover a very wide range of things that are important for management, right? Is that business processes will allow you business processes will allow you to cover these nine different aspects of management. Understanding your work, documenting your work so that your intellectual capital is preserved, your ways of working are preserved, even if somebody leaves the key people leave the organization. Innovate your work, which means change your work on a continuous basis to adapt to, you know, changing practices or changing customer demands. So these three different things can be achieved, well, to some extent at least, by identifying your business processes and documenting them, modeling your business process. By doing so, you get to understand what work is being performed in the organization, you get to document your organizational memory, and you get to a starting point for changing your current practices and innovating, right? Because you understand your current business practice and you can say, we are doing it this way, our competitors are doing it that way, therefore we are going to change this or this or that, right? The three other aspects are very important in particular in large organizations and government agencies. You need to control your business, you know, be able to steer it in a certain direction. You need to achieve transparency, that everybody's work is transparent to the management, and in the case of governments, to the citizen even. And compliance. People are following certain rules that reduce the risks in your organization. That's the pitch in the case of private companies. And in the governments, there's no need to sell compliance. They have already bought into it since 1775. Right. And the third thing that you care about is productivity, you know, making what you are currently doing with less resources or making more with the same amount of resources. Agility, you know, being able to adapt to new opportunities, to changes in your market, and customer satisfaction, and that is achieved by business process improvement methodologies. So modeling your processes, using improvement methods to improve your processes, managing your processes, allow you to cover like the nine facets of management that you want. You will agree this is what management is about, right? So business process management is a discipline that crosses all the concerns of management and that allows you to, you know, structure and revisit your management practices in a very holistic manner and achieve all the different objectives of your management unit. So you sell it on this holistic perspective by doing business process management. We are not going to solve only one specific problem in the organization, management problem in the business. We are going to set up the framework for managing a whole range of problems, of management problems across the organization. So we are going to model processes, and we are going to be using them for control, for transparency, for compliance, productivity, increasing productivity, increasing our ability to change, agility, and improving our customer satisfaction and all the KPIs that go behind. So it's like one investment for many different outcomes. And that is something that can help you sell BPM as a sustainable program, right? But of course, before you get to this point, you also have to previously have shown that business process management can help you to improve specific processes. So before making this pitch, it is very useful to start like guerrilla way, you know. If your organization has not started to do BPM, certainly the best thing to start doing BPM is to find the two processes where there are the lowest hanging fruits to improve them and what is hurting, and then try to improve those processes, get an awareness of what business process management can get among your management colleagues, and then start trying to sell the idea of an entire business process, sustainable business process management program as a way to cover holistically your organization. Which brings me to defining a little bit in a more structured way what business process management is about. It's about these three things that we saw in the previous table. I just like twisted around the table. It's about modeling your process on the one hand. It's about continuously improving your processes, you know, finding ideas to improve your process and implementing those ideas. And it's about continuously managing your processes, so making sure that what is important for your processes gets done. And each of these three facets of business process has addressed three of these nine management concerns that we saw before.
But it's a quite big amount of time and effort to have that. The manager will ask, what have you got from that?
Yeah.
Quickly.
Yeah, so that's why I think before making the big pitch for a BPM program, you should make the small pitch, which brings me to this one. This is more of so how do you get there? I think you first have to get your quick wins. You have to start guerrilla, small team, you know, of managers who feel like business processes improvement is the way to go, and get their first quick wins. You know, like, you know, getting selecting a few processes, mapping a few processes, selecting some processes that are perceived to be dysfunctional and at the same time important, work on them, propose improvements, convince the people to implement these improvements, and get some quick wins. And say, you know, by doing this in 2-3 different initiatives in the organization, we managed to do this. And perhaps you might already have done that. In many organizations, there has been business process management a bit here, a bit here, a bit here, just in an isolated framework. So you have developed a business process capability. You know, you have 2-3 people in the organization who have the capability to make changes in the organization by means of business process management. And while you're doing that, you start doing modeling. You model certain processes and you start getting a picture of what business processes there are in a certain part of the organization or maybe across the entire organization. So this is the first step. Starting by developing on the process ethos side, you know, process culture side, developing a process management capability, you know, 2-3 people who know about BPM and how to apply it, 2-3 users who know about BPM and how to use it, and an initial business process architecture. These are the processes in my company or my part of my company, and modeling some of these processes. And then you can move to the second step, which is developing now a community of people that, you know, are going to work together in different, you know, share expertise, you know, your mini BPM roundtable inside the organization type of thing, right? You know, different people have done BPM in isolated ways, and, you know, they have like every 2 weeks or every month a meeting to share their experiences, consolidate their stuff, you know, building a community of BPM. Maybe you start sharing your process models in a repository and say, we're going to put them all here so that everybody has access to everybody's process models and so on. And you start developing an improvement methodology. You start saying like, okay, developing a systematic way of engaging in improvement programs, right?
What you're saying is that you must have at least one board member who's supposed to try it.
I think the next thing is then you want to make the BPM culture organization-wide. And there you need a BPM program, right? That's when you want to go and sell the big one, right? So you want to create a group now, some sort of business process management BPM group in your organization that is implementing a BPM program and that consolidates all this knowledge and experience that was gathered through different isolated initiatives and comes up with a continuous process monitoring and management approach organization-wide, where all the processes in the organization, or most of them, are mapped, and for each of them, you know what are the key performance metrics, how are these processes performed, and you have a queue of business process improvement programs, projects that you are trying to champion. So, and here you kind of need to get at the board level, right? And if the board buys into it, there's the fourth level, which is saying that you start caring about your maturity. You have a BPM program and you want to make it sustainable. So, because typically a program would be 3 years, for example, and you want to make it a sustainable part of the organization beyond. So this is kind of how you move. You cannot, and then that means that you have to set up some sort of business process governance framework, rules for how people will model processes, update their processes, and share their processes, and so on. So a bunch of a framework that allows many different people in the organization to be involved in BPM, but at the same to have an overview. And indeed, one of the very common problems when introducing BPM in an organization is that people try to start here and here. Nobody into enterprise architecture here, I hope. Right? You are, right. So I'm going to try to moderate. Right? So sometimes BPM comes from the enterprise architecture side, and there is a problem that there is a tendency, not always, to start by already talking about, what is going to be our governance framework for BPM? You know, how are we going to manage our repositories of process models? You know, what tools are we going to start to use? You know, how are we going to customize them and configure them? How are we going to train people, et cetera, et cetera? Before we have actually gone through the process of creating the capability, the set of people who know about this process modeling and process improvement, the community of people who identify themselves with business process management, and the whole structure, the culture, which is like every process having an owner, every process being monitored and managed on a continuous basis. And only then you can come up with a governance framework on top of that, rather than the other way around. But I mean, this is just theory. In practice, it might work that enterprise architecture, the governance first approach can work, right? But then you have to have high level management backing for that. Right? Big bang BPM. Right? And a final word before we go to the break is a little mention of our friends. I can understand that managers are a bit sometimes sick and tired because, there is Lean Six Sigma, total quality management, and these are just four out of a lot of different, streams of management around. And now there is BPM, right? And my answer is like, no, there is not like, and now it is BPM. There has always been BPM. So long as you have had processes in your organization, hopefully there has been some management of those processes, right? So BPM is not trying to supplant anybody here, right? You can do BPM, you can improve your business process with Lean, and that is phenomenal, fantastic, great. Yeah, you can improve your business process with Six Sigma, and this is fantastic, it is great, phenomenal, right? It's all like, they are all sisters. Nobody is battling with anybody here. BPM is about continuously managing and improving your process, having a culture of continuously managing and improving your processes. Whatever it takes to do so, it's perfectly fine. Yeah? The question that might be valid is like, if I want to manage and improve my business processes, is it a good idea to start with Six Sigma straight away? or is it a good idea to start with Leap, right? And I would say, like, that will depend on your company, right? I mean, if you are a manufacturing company, yeah, most likely it makes a lot of sense to start with Six Sigma, right? If you are a company that has many type customers and many different types of customers, like a mass company, right? It makes tremendous sense to start with Lean, right? Because this is what Lean is trying to achieve. You know, it's like you have like very different requirements from your customers, and you try to satisfy them with the minimal amount of bureaucracy and overhead inside your organization. And that is fine. You can improve your customer-facing processes with Lean, and that might be your very first step to BPM. That might be like the first little thing you start doing towards a continuous management of business processes, right? And business process is just like, you know, not going beyond. Nobody is above anybody here. Right? It's just like a discipline of trying to establish a culture of continuous management, mapping, and improvement of your processes, right? And monitoring as well of your processes. And that is what it is about. So there are no BPM black belts, right? It's like it's you. Because nobody at the end can give you your processes overall. So some people will tell you, oh, we have best practice business processes. Right? This is the best practice business process in this industry. This is how you should do insurance claims. Fantastic. It might very well be the case, theoretically. But business processes like this, it's like you, your organization has to own it, has to feel they are ours. Right? You cannot get them like that in your hands out and put them in your pocket. Now I have a business process. No. You have to absorb the business process, right? So and that's why I tell people there will always be business process managers. So will not run out of work. They might be called differently, but they will always be, because business process cannot be sold in a box. Even if someone tells you this is the right way of doing things, it's like, well, the right in general, but the right for me might be completely different. And even if this is the right for me, my organization has to absorb these processes for them to really become my processes. And therefore, you still need business process management. Anybody into ITIL here? Yes, ITIL. Okay, ITIL is this IT infrastructure library. You know, process is a whole framework for managing process for IT service delivery. And I think that is fantastic. I mean, it's a tremendous body of knowledge, just like PMBOK, as I put before. No, ITIL is a tremendous body of knowledge. But one thing that has been misused in ITIL in some organizations is that ITIL tells you these are the processes. This is the process for issue, this type of issue took a solution, this is a process for this, this is a process for that. And then organizations buy that pack, you know, a tool like Visual Process, Visual Architect with some HP ITIL plugin and say, okay, these are going to be our processes. And that's not going to work. You know, it has to become your processes by you doing them. You know, it's like by you absorbing those processes that they become your process. And while you absorb them, those processes mix with your organizational DNA and they become something else, right? And then those are your processes. So yeah. And that's, I think I have talked too much again. So say something.
What about this APQC?
APQC. Okay, so let me list them all. They are called reference frameworks, reference process frameworks, right?
Yes.
So I mentioned first PMBOK for processes for project management, right? And there is much more to that than PMBOK. This is ITIL, this is processes for IT service delivery, right? You mentioned APQC. APQC is a bit of a different beast. Huh? It has some reference architectures. It's like them cataloging all sorts of processes that you have seen in different organizations. And they use them rather not so much to tell you this is your process. In fact, APQC has very few really procedural processes to give you. Yeah, it's names of processes. You need to have a process. You might have a process for this, you might have a process for that, you might have a process for that, APQC has this other approach which says, like, okay, you do your process whatever way you want, and in fact, we cannot tell you how to do your process. We focus on defining the KPIs for your processes. Well, I'll say APQC's main strength is in defining the list of processes that you might have, and for each of them, the KPIs, the typical performance indicators for how this process performs. And for each of these process indicators, they give you, in some reports that are very expensive, the benchmarks based on their data gathered from their own consortium, because it's a very big consortium. What is the industry, in your industry, what is the typical value for the KPI out of stocks per day or something like that, in a particular, related to a particular process of your organization, or percentage of unresolved customer complaints, you know, and so on. So they will have KPIs in your industry. One thing I can tell you is how reliable those KPIs are, you know, how representative they are of your industry. But you need to have a target, right, for it to change. And it's very convincing when you say, for this business process, APQC says that KPI X is that we are below industry average with respect to this KPI. And then management say, wow, how come we are below management? Oh, we have to solve that, right? Ah, but we need BPM for that. Great, let's do BPM. So that's another way of selling BPM, right? There is another one called ETOM here, which is for the telecommunications industry. And then there is a favorite, most famous one, right, of course, SCORE, DECORE, and so on. This is supply chain management, right? And design, product design management. SCORE also, by the way, is a mix of, also has a bit of this APQC approach that for every process they define KPIs. But it also has things from the other ones where they kind of define a bit procedurally different processes. And that resembles the ITIL approach, right? Oh, yeah. Right, and we have a coffee break now. This is great, looking forward. And when we come back, we're going to go through this business process lifecycle. We're going to talk about identifying your processes.
It works a lot.
No, not in monochrome there. Here I have colors and there I don't have colors. So keep that in mind.
Very strange. Black, white.
The red is one, but the blue is okay.
I think it is just need some tuning.
Two, I'm going to be talking about. I think this issue of the customer has raised a lot of debates. It's good to worry about who the customer is. I have given a lot of seminars, but this is the first time that we have so much discussion about who the customer is. So it didn't ever occur to me that that was a problem, but apparently it is a problem. And we'll come back to the problem as we go along. Okay, so part two of this seminar, our three parts, it's we'll start to go through the typical life cycle of a business process. This is like business process management is about managing business processes. Every process goes, when you start managing it, go through a life cycle. And it's a circle. Huh? You're never done with a process. You can always improve it. You can always understand it better. But the first thing you have to do is to identify what your process is. Right? We call that process identification. And if you do it for a bunch of processes in the organization, you get something called your process architecture. You know, so it's like, this is how I can see my organization if I talk in terms of processes. It's like the organizational chart, but instead of functions or departments, you have processes. Once we have identified there is a process, you know, order to cash in this particular part of the organization, we have to understand the process in some detail, and we call that process discovery. So we go as business process managers or modelers, we go and we talk to the people who do the process. How does it look like from the moment we receive a purchase order to the moment we receive the payments? And you have to talk to a bunch of people to get that picture. And you document that picture, and typically, this is practice, the outcome of that will be some sort of process model. That will be some diagram plus a lot of documentation about a lot of business rules and other guidelines that are used by the people who execute the process. And once we have this assist process model, we can sit down and analyze it. We can figure out, yes?
Can you be a bit more specific on how we discover processes in the real life?
Right.
How we identify that certain thing is a process?
That's what we're going to talk about first. That first, you have to scope the process. You have to say, this is a process. And actually, typically, you start by saying, I have a process in mind, and it's this one. And you will end up actually with four or five processes. So it's not one process. It turned out it was four or five. Right? So that's identification. So if that's the question, like, how do we know this is a process? Without going into the details of how it is done, then the answer is coming in 2 minutes. Right? That's okay? Or do you want to say, if I have a process already, how do I get to gather the documentation for that, document that process? Is that
I've more thought that basically we all agree that there are some processes out there.
Yeah.
So how we kind of identify how many of them and which they are. And
I don't need to say anymore what process identification is. You just ask it. Exactly. Yeah, that's process identification, is figuring out how many processes there are and which ones there are and how they are related. That's process identification, and you build a process identification. Then you take a process and you discover it, you analyze it, different techniques, you try to find ways of improving it, you produce a 2D process, and then you implement and monitor it. So just to give context, this part I'm going to deal with identification, which is exactly the question Arab just asked. You know, how do you get to know which processes I have? How many are there? How are they related? You know? Then we talk about taking one process at a time, just one, and trying to understand it. Right. So this is part two right now. And in the afternoon, we'll look very quickly at process analysis and process redesign. And I'm not going to go into process implementation, by the way. That's probably involves a lot of IT and it's none of your concern. And I'm not going to go to process monitoring, which is probably something you really will be interested in, but unfortunately, there will be no time for that. Right. So, first steps, process identification. How do I identify a process? So the first thing here to understand is that when you identify processes, it's important not only to identify processes, but also to assess them and prioritize them. There is no point in getting a list of 50 processes and put them in a nice picture if you do not get an understanding of which ones are more important, which ones are less important, right? So we will put two things together, figuring out what processes is and which ones are important and which ones are functional or dysfunctional and so on in the same goal. So we're going to start by enumerating processes and get some tips and tricks for that. Then scoping the process. For each process, we're going to say, is this really one process or is this two or three processes? And we have already seen straight away, just one example, that you have two or three processes in mind in the same process. So then we get a bunch of processes out of that, and we will start ordering them. You know, we will try to ask three questions. How important, let's put it that way, strategically relevant a given process is? How healthy is this process right now? And what is the politics behind this process? You know, among the stakeholders that have an eye on this process, you know, how likely are they that they will be able to change it, that you will be able to change it? You will back your initial assessments with performance measures, and that will give you a list of prior, an architecture, meaning set of processes in the relationships, and a list of prioritized processes and performance measures for each process. Okay, now how do we get to enumerate processes in an organization where we have previously not enumerated? So I'm going to start the easy version and the more complicated version. The first thing is that I'll bet you that most businesses, private ones especially, not so much government ones, have three processes. Yeah? There is you sell, you deliver, and you make sure that you have things to sell and deliver. Those are your three, we will call them core processes. This is the frame. So you have your core processes are here. Between your customers, and your customer is the one who gives the money to your company, right? Behind him, there can be also users who are the ones that kick this customer to actually pay. Okay? So there are customers, and the core processes are characterized by the fact that you talk to the customer, or actually it's the customer who starts them. The initial event of the process is initiated by a customer, or is indirectly initiated by the customer. And then you have usually some business partners, I would call them. It's not necessarily only suppliers. It can be contractors. It can be all sorts of business partners you have, and that help you to deliver those processes. And in this process, core processes, you will typically have something that is close to the user called sale, and you will have something perhaps a little bit, depends on the organization, but a little bit more on the back, which is to deliver what the customer asked of you. And the third one will be making sure you have stuff to sell and deliver. So this is the framework for you to start enumerating your core processes. Yes?
But I understand the customer do not consume the process, but consume some product.
He consumes the outcome of the
outcome,
process.
Yes.
Yeah.
So the outcome should be separately described. Because even they, if you have some suppliers, they give you some service. So with Rama, I understand we make the direct connection between supplier and process.
I said that you sell something to a customer and use something from some business partners in doing so. Yeah. And they are both part of your process.
Okay. So we should focus what's between the process and the supplier and the process and the customer.
Yeah, let's put a boundary here.
Okay.
Right. And let's put a boundary. Here is kind of my process, right? Yeah. So sometimes though the customer is kind of quite involved in the process, they even perform some activities in the process. Right. So this is one way of seeing it. If that is not enough for you to think what are your core processes, another way of taking it is to take what do you want, cash, and what do you get at the beginning, potential customers. Also called lead. And this doesn't mean that you don't know the customer before, right? I mean, it can be a customer you already know, but you want to sell them something new, right? So it's a lead. So you have lead and you have cash. Right? And you have a big process that goes from lead to cash. Someone potentially can buy something to somebody buys you something. Yeah? And you can start decomposing there. Maybe I have a process lead to from lead to quote. Lead to quote, yeah. And I have another one from quote to a order. And I have another one from order to delivery. And perhaps another one from delivery to cash. And sometimes cash comes before delivery, but that's a detail. Just a way of saying it. So your organization, in principle, should have these processes. Right? And if you are a government organization, what happens is typically that you don't care about your leads. Your leads are there all the time. That's fantastic. Don't care too much about the quote. In fact, your business starts from here, and there is a citizen need, an expressed citizen need, I would say. That could be a request for an application permit, for a permit to do something. That could be a request to resolve a problem. You know, I call the city council, and you know, there is a garbage bin sitting in front of the door of my house, right? And it's not mine. To the point where the problem is you have delivery, resolution of the citizen's need. So that could be application to approval, hopefully. That's a nice case. Or that could be some issue, customer issue to resolution. And so on. Okay. So anybody's core processes, is there any one of you who thinks of a process that does not fall there? Core process. We're talking to your real customers.
I have a question. For example, if you have a power plant, then you have a repair procedure. If you have the maintenance company, then it's your core process, otherwise it's just
offline service. I had this experience in Australia of a company called WaterCorp. As you can imagine, WaterCorp is some sort of utilities provider for water, right? And they sell, they were engaging in VPN because it came from the upper management, and their business analysts were saying, we don't have customers. So they, well, there are no customers. Well, occasionally somebody asks us to see that they notice there is a spill somewhere, you know, and we have to go and fix it. But it's not that. I mean, if anybody, their customers, when you have these maintenance processes, your customer is the owner of the infrastructure, right? You know, you have a dam, and the owner of the dam, typically the government, somehow your customers, you are running the dam of water and throwing water into the water system on behalf of the government. At Italina Vesi, they have to do sewerage, right? Have to collect sewerage, rainwater. And their customer is some city council. And after city council, no longer the city council, apparently the government decided that the city council was not a good customer and they gave it to the a competition regulator. It's funny because a competition regulator is a bad customer. Yeah, you have a very abstract type of customer. But you still, in a maintenance facilities management or infrastructure management, we call it infrastructure management business, you still will have issues that pop up. Somebody noticed them, it might be yourself, it might be others, and you still have resolutions.
It's
deals,
not
yeah?
more, in for power plants, it's not core business because they don't work and don't money to repair the thing, or machines.
Yeah, but they would not be able to earn money at all if they didn't have the stuff repaired.
It's like a supporting procedure for them.
Ah, you mean an energy producer that is also retailer.
Yeah.
So it has both businesses.
Yeah.
As a retail. It might be useful there to conceptually at least split it into two different businesses. There is a business that is that has a very clear customer, which is the utilities provider that provides utility to a customer, and the customer pays bills, right? So that's one business. And the other one is the power production, or in this case, Water Corp was a water production and distribution, right? And the water production distribution doesn't have customers, actually. They are not the ones who actually sell the bill to a customer. They are just responsible for maintaining the thing, and they then sell water in big chunks to the retailer, the water retailer, or a power plant sells electricity in big chunks to the electricity to the electricity retailer. Two businesses, different sets of customers, and very different processes. And then there has to be a mechanism for one to pay to the other. By kilowatt, megawatt, or whatever watts hour, or something like that, so that you can separate the two businesses, and then you have two different processes. Maintenance, infrastructure maintenance, or facilities maintenance processes are very different beasts. And indeed, there is this notion that there is not a retail customer, it's not a customer for each execution of the process. Each time there is some little problem in the power plant and it has to be repaired, there's no customer who triggered that. There is a wholesale customer, which is, if you are a wholesale power producer, is the retail power producers who are buying electricity from you. Or the wholesale water producer is the retail water companies who are your customers. And they're buying you in big chunks. In a way, they are not driving every single execution of your process. You have to be responsible for the execution of the processes. And some companies will resolve it by creating management positions. Like, I'm an infrastructure management position. I need a power plant. I need to deal with risks. I need to deal with a production planning and distribution planning. I need to deal with quality management. You know. And then I will create management positions for these ones. And they are going to be like the responsible to be the customers of certain internal processes to maintain the whole company alive.
Just what I'm trying to say that, for example, this maintenance procedure can be a core business for the one company and auxiliary service for another company.
Oh, yeah. When you interact with business partners, they have their own processes, yeah. That's why I just put the boundary here, mm-hmm. saying the world is more complex, but I'm currently analyzing my part in that world. Yeah. Yeah. True. Okay, so apart from that, which still fits in here, yeah. So I'm just going to say that What we conclude is indeed that there are some, I would call it, retail customers. They buy you every time. They buy you something, buy something. It can be another company, by the way, but every time they buy you something, they trigger an order for it. And there are some sort of big wholesale customers. Two different types. And the power plant, I mean. It's a big wholesale customer, which is like the other company that is buying them big chunks of electricity. And in the wholesale customer scenario, one way of structuring it is that internally, you will create a whole bunch of other customers. Like I was saying, that could be the risk manager, This could be the quality manager, a production planning manager, etc., who then kind of become customers of your process. Any other core process you think that are core, you talk to the customers and it's not there in the piece. Right. Okay. So that's what it goes. But it's not all. Core processes, also called primary activities, are just one part of the picture of a company. This is a picture that dates back from the 80s and is in the context of manufacturing companies. The manufacturing companies will have inbound logistics where they get supplies into their warehouses, operations where they actually produce, manufacturing, marketing and sales where they generate leads, outbound logistics where they ship things to their customers, finished products to their customers, and some after-sales service. I forgot that one. After the cash, it doesn't stop there, unfortunately. After the cash, there is the issue or fault, and then there is the resolution. Right. And this is also a core process, the after sales issue and the after sales resolution. Okay, so these are your core processes, also called primary activities. And this is what I kind of plotted here. Every process you have in your organization will be there. And you enumerate by just saying, how many variants of these I have? I have one probably per product. I have one per type of customer segment or market. If you are in different countries, I have one per country. And if you have a government organization, you have different types of citizen requests. And for each of them, you will have one of these core processes. And you can start enumerating them. And it becomes an exercise of enumerating essentially the services that your company provides. And that way you are enumerating the processes that your company is providing.
Service and procedure can be
Not necessarily, because of what we said. So every service in theory generates a process variant, a variant of your process. But sometimes, pragmatically, there are different services you provide that are just so similar. For example, currency in a bank. A bank offers currency conversion services, currency transaction services, FX services, foreign exchange. Some of these foreign exchange transactions are very similar to one another. So the major currencies are very similar, and the less traded currencies are different. And you will define not a variant, let's say, per currency, but you will define a variant per group of currencies or things like that, or type of transaction.
For the one procedure, also, you can have different outputs. For example, if you have some construction company, you can evaluate the quality of the documentation that you will get, and you can improve it, and you can develop something new. The same procedure, but you can have different outcomes. But the procedure is the same.
Yeah, that's the case. A process can have multiple outcomes.
Right.
Yeah, a process can have multiple outcomes.
So
yeah.
One more question. And now you introduced the supporting procedures. Earlier, I had the management procedures.
No,
procedures.
Supporting is the management are different. No, they are not the same. So now I go to my second thing. So if we settle that that's okay for the core processes, below your core process, I'm going to put them kind of below. Here is posted above, but I kind of like to put them below. There are the support processes. And the support processes are meant to make sure that you have the infrastructure, the resources, that you need in order to support, to produce your main processes, right? So here there will be IT, right? That's a famous support processes, IT. There is HR, By the way, I'm making a mistake here. These are not processes. These are like functional areas where there are processes inside. But I'm just like abusing it, right? Well, you have recruitment processes, let's say. You have procure to pay. A very typical support process. Issue to resolution in IT, a very typical support process. Recruitment in human resource, a very typical recruit process. Firing, that's a very typical, unfortunately. In facilities maintenance, facilities management. That's not a process. Facilities management is not a process, it's an area of the organization. But in facilities management, there are issue to resolution for maintenance activities. Oh, I have a problem with my, the painting in my office is falling down. So then they have to send somebody to do some repair, or please come and open this door here because somebody left it, you know, closed, right? So
risk management, supporting management.
Oh, yeah. But risk management, again, is not a process, right?
But it's like a compliance topic, so it's like a management topic.
Risk management is not a process, of course. It's a bunch of processes.
But which area?
They do not support. Yeah, they do not directly support. Nobody in your organization calls risk management because it has to be the idea that there is an event that triggers. Nobody calls their risk management, risk management, please, there is a risk here, please, mitigate it. No, it doesn't happen that way. Whereas infrastructure management, facilities management has this, we have a problem in our building, we need merge two rooms together because we need a larger room.
Can we define it in that way, that supporting procedure are the procedures that we can outsource? Or service that we can outsource?
No. It's true that there is this philosophy in modern management that you should focus on your core activities and try to outsource the rest. So I guess that creates the impression that you can outsource supporting processes, right? I mean, if you outsource a core process, then it's no longer core in a way, right? Yeah. Some people do outsource inbound logistics, right? You can say it's a core process. So you can, and maybe one day you will pick it back, by the way, right? So it's no. I think it's kind of orthogonal, but I understand that there is a management trend to say, let's focus on our core activities, and because of that, outsourcing happens a lot in the support processes, right? Yeah. You outsource quite a lot of IT, processes, you outsource quite a lot of facilities management processes and so on. But you're right. In risk management, I have a problem finding a process that is a support process. Yes?
Depends what you mean by risk management. In the companies which main business is to sell and buy risks,
insurance company.
You have to have also your risk management that manages the supply and make sure that you have something to sell or buy.
I would say that in the insurance companies, reinsurance will be even part of the core process. Reinsurance, risk assessment, risk assessment. Like I come up with a special request, I want an insurance for my business that covers me for this and this and that, and actuary has to come and do an assessment of the risk. In an insurance company, that is a core process, and it wouldn't be excluded that in banking it happens too, that in your core process that you have some risk assessment activities, yes?
But on other type of company that needs to manage the risks related to overall operations, it is a part of the government structure.
Yeah.
And in that case, we have also a customer. Owner of the company is the customer, actually.
The shareholders, yeah.
Shareholders.
There is indeed another type of custom of processes that I will call management processes. So three types of customers: core processes, three types of processes. Core processes, the customer is external. Support processes, typically the customer is internal. The people who are there, you know, are asking you to do things. Yeah? People doing the core process ask you to do that. And sometimes even the people here ask you to do that as well. And then you start getting so far away from the customer that you wonder whether you have to do this. And then there are the management process. And yes, management process has as customers, the shareholder, not only, regulators as well. Mainly these two. Shareholders and regulators, who typically want a bit the opposite. Right? They want to get the money, and the other one, you know, make sure that you try not to get money. Too much money. So you have management process, and I would say, like in a typical organization that you will think of, you know, some risk assessment or monitoring processes happen here. The process of process improvement happen here. Business development, or a bunch of process around business development, project management. Strategic planning. They are all happening in here. So, and they are processes that control all the other processes and that whose customers are shareholders and regulators. Or in the case of government, here the customers are citizens, and here the customer is the state or something like that, behind which is the set of citizens as a whole. You know, you are working for the interest of the citizens of Estonia as a whole. Right? So you don't have shareholders; you rather have these guys here. Or you are in a government agency and your customer is a ministry. Right? Typical one government agency reports to one ministry. And the minister is the customer of the management processes of that government agency instead of a shareholder. Right? And the idea is, this is the theory, Porter's theory, is that every process will fall here. So if you start saying, examining your lead to cash and issue to resolution processes, then you look at everything that supports those processes, technology, human resources, procurement, facilities management, and you look at all the processes inside those areas. And then you look at your shareholders and regulators and what do they want and what is done to achieve their goals. Then you enumerate your management process, you enumerate this, and this, you pretty much have your processes. Yeah?
Whether it is a process separate or somehow how they interconnect also.
Yes, so I'll get to interconnection in a minute. Yeah, right. So but I guess these are the three broad process areas that come up from this Porter's value chain model. Porter didn't have the management process, but people added them afterwards because they said, they distinguished that there are some support processes that are internal or triggered by internal customers, people who work in the organization triggering the process, versus support processes that are meant for a wider good, which typically is the shareholder, and they are quite different because they are maybe not executed all the time very often, but they are only executed from time to time. And it is correct to say that human resource management, all processing human resources are support, by the way. Some of them are support, some of them are management. In fact, some HR departments are divided into like operational HR and strategic HR management. So operational HR is dealing with, you know, day-to-day, you know, contracting, recruiting, firing, managing rosters, etc., and strategic HR is dealing with the development of HR policies in the organization as a whole, right? And spinning off large HR improvement projects. So then we have this framework, and we say we want to identify process in the organization. So we have to first say, where do we start? And I think in a very natural place to start, of course, is core processes. You start by enumerating your company's core processes, right? This is, in an ideal world, that's where BPM will start, and that's where you will start. You will take your lead to cash, try to map it to what does it mean in my organization, lead, what is a customer lead, and what is cash, what is an issue, what is a resolution, and try to enumerate your core processes. But occasionally, it happens that BPM in an organization does not stem from core processes, but it stems from supporting a organization. So it's not uncommon that the first process you will look at is procure to pay. Because it's the people in procurement who had a problem, their processes are very inefficient, and the top managers told them, you have to cut costs, and then they have to look at BPM from a cost-cutting perspective. And then BPM can start by from this side, and you will start by enumerating what are the processes I have around procure to pay. I have restocking, planning my restocking, forecasting my demand, making purchase orders, making payments, and so on. Ah, by the way, finance, I forgot. So important, finance. By the way, not all finance is support. A typical finance department is divided into accounts payable, accounts receivable, and the other, let's say, strategic management and reporting. So accounts payable, which is you pay invoices, and accounts receivable. Accounts payable is support, is the invoices you have to pay. The accounts receivable, which deals with making sure that the invoices you send are paid, is part of core processes. And then there is a strategic financial management. And that is a management process, of course. So you see, like, process decomposition and organizational decomposition are two completely different beasts. You say finance management, you say, is that core, is that support, is that what? And when you look at the process level, you realize that in finance management, there are parts that are core. The people who send the invoice, accounts payable, and who receive the payment, sorry, accounts receivable, I got it completely wrong, yeah, accounts receivable, the people who receive money, they are core. The people who receive invoices and have to pay them, they are support. Typically, it's a result of you purchasing things, so it's part of your procure-to-pay process. And there are the people who do all the strategic reporting and planning and, you know, general ledger and your annual reports and stuff like that. Annual reporting, preparing an annual report is a very typical management process that every organization has. The financial, preparing your monthly or annual financial, quarterly or annual financial reports for tax authorities, for example. And that's management. So when you decompose an organization functionally, it's funny how you get to organizational units that are very hybrid, because some of them are supporting your customers, are talking to your customers. Some of them are talking internally with your employees. Some of them are talking with the higher management and the shareholders. And it's all combined in the same unit. When you talk processes, it's as if you were splitting your organization by types of customers. Right? So you get a very different division. Who is the customer that is triggering this work? Is it my real customer external? Is it some internal customer, somebody else in the organization? Or is it a upper management and shareholders or regulators? And that's how you cut the organization, from the customers into the organization. And not from what needs to be done or not a thematic decomposition of your theme-based decomposition of your organization. Right. Any process enumeration exercise has a limit, 10 to 20 main processes. So what about that? You come up with your first 10 processes in your organization. Okay, so we will not discuss individual processes. Your list of processes, you keep it to you. Just, is there any process now that didn't fit into the picture that you thought of? Right. Okay. Is there any process for which you couldn't manage who the customer is? Internal or external? No, everything fine there. Now, if you enumerated more than three processes, is there any chance some of these processes are related? Or are they completely independent? Okay. They are related. Processes do not exist in isolation, they are related. And like any time when we come up with a new management discipline that starts by splitting your organization into pieces, which makes a lot of sense, divide and conquer, there's always the thing that these pieces are interdependent. Right? One type of interdependency, you know it from the organizational chart, is that one of them is above the others. Right? Hierarchical dependencies. So in process, that's not uncommon. For example, you might start to say that I have a lead to cash process. And behind this process, there is a lead to quote. There is a quote from the moment I send a quote to the moment I set an order. There is a order to delivery and delivery to cash. So this means this is a top process, and these guys here are called sub-processes. And a sub-process can have more sub-processes, can have more sub-processes. So there is that one type of relation. One process encompasses the other one, and the other one is that one process uses the output of the other one. So the quote, when you get a customer lead, and you call the customer and you negotiate with them and you end up sending them a quote, that's one process. And the output of that is a quote you send to a customer, and ideally the customer comes back and is interested, right? And then you keep following up. So what do you think about this quote? Yeah, I like it, but I would like this and this and that as well. We have to issue a new quote, you know? And you follow up with the customer, you negotiate, and eventually the customer says, yes, I want you to do this job, right? You get the order. And that order is then the input for order to delivery. And that ends up when you deliver something to the customer. And not necessarily sequentially, but in parallel. But nonetheless, one is the input to the other, is that once you have delivered, if you deliver, then you will ask for payment. And maybe it's not temporal, it's in sequence, it might be a bit in parallel. You might be paying at different points in time during the delivery. So it's not a full sequential, but the point is that a delivery by you leads to invoicing the customer, or delivering part of the job leads to invoicing the customer, getting the payment, and so on. So you have these blue relations now, which are we call them upstream downstream relations, and what we're doing here is to upstream downstream relations, which is capturing the dependencies. And there are other types of relations. I didn't think we will go into it, but you already identify. Sometimes one process supports another one. So for example, order to delivery is supported by a process called a refilling, stock replenishment, which is a process that starts from the moment you detect that there is something in your stock that is low to the moment you order it and you get it, so that your stock goes back to normal levels. And this process is supporting this process. If you didn't do that, you wouldn't be able to deliver. And a fourth type of relation is the governance or management relation, right? So stock replenishment is when you go out of stock to the moment you replenish. Behind that, there is a management process. It's typically called demand forecasting, where you try to predict changes, what will be the demand for a given item on stock in your warehouse next month. Right? So that is a management process, and this process somehow governs this one, because it tells you what policies you will use for stock replenishment. We saw in government agencies that there are upper-level management processes that derive policies that would then be used by the processes below. So four types of relations. One process can be a sub-process of another one. One process can be upstream. This is upstream and this is downstream with respect to another one. One process can support another one. One process can govern another one or manage it. Any other relations you can see between your 10 processes?
Then management also have different levels.
So there can be a management process governing another management process.
Question, do you have those management processes for procedure?
For process improvement, yeah. One of the management processes I wrote before was the process of process improvement.
That is part of the core procedure.
No, management. That's management. It's governing. It's deriving rules and policies and guidelines that will be used by the lower level policy.
So even the operational management is a management.
Operations management is not a process. It's too broad.
It's planning resources and stuff like that.
Yeah. Resource planning starts looking like a process. It's from the moment you determine you have to replan the amount of resources you will need for next month to the moment you come up with the plan for managing your resources for the following month, that is a management process. Right. And the key question is to know, I have the right granularity of a process, because you can do process of process of process, and you can start splitting in this upstream, downstream as much as you want, and you can have lots of supporting processes and governing processes that you can start splitting. So there are five key questions to say, this is a process, I should stop, let's not go further, right? So the first question is like, is when does the process start? Is it very clear when does it start? Right? If I cannot say this process starts here, then maybe I don't have a process. I have a process area. Maybe there are many processes here. I need to continue digging below if I want to find processes. And so there has to be a very clear start. Is there a definition of when does the process finish? Because if something is ongoing all the time, then it's not the process, right? So again, operations management, well, it's something you do all the time, right? Risk management, well, it's something I do all the time. So you have to dig deeper until you get to something that is really a process. It has a clear start, it has a clear finish. And because it has a clear start, you can see who the customer behind is, because typically it's the customer who will kick the process to start, right? But that's not enough. Huh? Lead to cash has that. I know very clearly when it starts, when I have a customer lead, I know there's a potential customer here, and I know where it ends, is when I get the cash, right? But it's not fine-grained enough yet. Well, it's a great place to start, but I need to go a little bit deeper. Why? Because in lead to cash, there are too many objects involved. First, there is like an informal object, which is the document, the lead. The customer called and inquired about something. I have a potential customer. I will enter it into my Salesforce.com system, whatever you use for customer relationship management, and I'll follow this lead, right, as a salesperson. Then there are things that have to do with preparing a quote and following up on the quote and getting a purchase order. That's another set of documents, the quote and the order. And then there is a delivery, and there I need to get some paper from the customer that acknowledges the service was delivered, right? The delivery receipt, we call it, or that the customer received the physical products we sent to them, so delivery receipt. Or the shipment notice, and then we have this invoice part. So there are a lot of documents involved in there, very different, right? If you look at the quote is one thing, invoice is a completely different thing, right? There might be an invoice for five orders corresponding to 10 quotes. So the process is not fine-grained enough. Another way to recognize it is that you lose stuff in the middle. Some processes will go to lead to quote and will never continue. Some instances of this process, we call them, of lead to cash will stop at the quote. Others will stop at the order. Hopefully nobody stops just at delivery, but it does happen that there are unpaid invoices, unfortunately, and others go to cash. So you are losing stuff in the middle. That means that it is not enough to stay at this level. You have to get one level down. And then you have stuff that don't really look like processes. Huh? Lead to quote. Either you get to the quote or you don't get to it. That's a negative outcome. Quote to order. Either from the quote you go to the order or you don't get from it. That's a negative outcome. Order to delivery. Either you manage to get to the delivery or the customer canceled the order in the meantime and then you don't have delivery. Delivery to cash. Either the customer paid or didn't pay. So now I have like very clear, not only very clear starts and ends, but pretty much one object or document for every process I have at this level. And then that looks like the right level. Now I can start discovering this process. I will call these my processes, right? Very clear start, very clear end, a very small number or maybe even only one object or document per process at the bottom level. Of course, at the top level, there can still be some higher level processes. And clear ownership. Clear ownership? Well, this is very clear. Who owns these ones? Sales manager. And his folks. Right? This is sales. Okay, this is sales. This is probably production or delivery. And this one is accounts receivable. a financial manager at the accounts receivable. So very clear ownership for each of these processes, right?
One question about these naming conventions. When you understand the procedure, then you all the time say from to.
Yeah, that's very typical.
Okay.
Just to make sure, I sometimes will call them differently, yeah? Like demand forecasting, right? Comes from the moment where you have to revise, comes a date where you have to revise your demand, start of the month, to the moment you have a demand forecast for the coming month.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it's not very fancy to call this 25th of the month too, I have a forecast. And then I call it demand forecasting for the following months. Right? So I mean, be pragmatic with naming, of course, but it is very common to name start event to end event, because then you're sure this is a process, right? Clear start, clear end. Clear owner, one object, maybe two. It's the quote and the lead. If you explicitly record the customer lead in your CRM, then it's two objects. It doesn't matter, right? Small number of coherent object, clear owner. And here comes a trick. So you have these bottom level processes, second level process, and you have this high level process. And then the question is, I know who owns this process. I know who owns this process. This is the production manager. I know who owns the process. I know who owns the process. Who the hell owns this process? It could be a board member, or it could be like the head of the sales department or something like that, that would be managing the guy who manages all these guys here, who will be owning the whole lead to cash process. It is typical that it is either this guy or sometimes this guy, not in this case. The one at the end or the one at the start, right? The ones in the middle tend to be like less critical in that respect.
What do you mean by owner?
In an organization that has been doing BPM for, let's say, more than 3 or 4 years and has had some BPM successes, there is a tradition that every process will have a manager. Could be a manager of a department, of a business line. It could be another manager, or could be a board member in some cases, who will be the owner of that process, which means that you will attach KPIs, process performance indicators, to the process, and that person is responsible for monitoring and managing those KPIs, and they are accountable for it. They you know, their bonus depends on that KPI.
Has power to change the procedure.
That's the problem, is that organizations are typically structured functionally, in many cases for a good reason, and the game of power is at the functional level. In the organizational structure, you divide by departments, and it's the heads of departments and who have the power. The power goes along the organizational chart. And then you bring in these processes, and the problem is that unless you have a matrix organization, you know, so there are departmental managers and process managers, and both of them have equal powers, or their powers are interplaying. If you have like a traditional one-dimensional organizational chart, just along departments, then you have this political game that you recognize processes are important. How important it is that my lead to cash process is functioning, right? But the manager of this process, say, will be a head of sales, does not have enough power over this guy, let alone over this one.
If you have the product owners.
Yeah. Yes?
Isn't the border of organizational unit a very natural border also for a process?
Well, the theory is that if you do not cross, I mean, the most tricky processes are those that cross organizational units, where there are handoffs.
Yeah, just said that maybe it's best to treat processes so that they don't cross.
And it will happen.
Avoid the problem.
And they, yes. if you don't have power to change the organizational chart, what you can do is what we did here. We decomposed the process to the point that this is one, this happens in one department, this happens in one department, this happens in one department, this happens in one department. But my question is, then, well, who is the manager of this one here?
But do we have this one? This one is then only a group of processes.
It's a group of processes, a process that has five or six of processes. It's a value chain. We call it a value chain. It's a value chain, right? It's important. Everybody will say it's important. The problem is who manages it and who has the power to change things. So process management and the process ownership role is a very political role, right? So this is about politics now. Okay, this is no longer about management. So let me say that there is a person here who, at this level, he is a manager. He manages processes. He's lead to quote process. He has full power over the people who are doing the work, the salespeople who are doing the work of getting leads and converting them into quotes. And he goes here and he becomes a process owner. And in here, he's no longer a manager. Let me call him. He's a politician, right? He has to play balance of powers. Convince people that it's in the best interest of everybody to do this process change, right? Imagine convincing that we are not going to send the invoice before delivery, whereas before we were doing it. Right? And then trying to convince the finance manager that that's the way to do it. With all the mess that that causes. So it's like we have at the bottom level, there's no problem, as Adar says. It's like very clear who the manager, the process owner, has power. But at this level, we need to turn some managers into politicians so that things happen across the company. Or else, we tell ourselves as an organization that lead to cash is not important. And that is fine. Some organizations have tried it. Many are not here to tell their story. And it's a never-ending game. This is what business process management is not. It's not, unfortunately, something you will engage in and give up in 3 years or 5 years and stop it. No. It's not going to happen. It's going to be a continuous game of this and that. And here is like the conclusion for process scoping. So we enumerated processes and now we scope them. We relate them and we define their boundaries clearly. And we conclude that a well-scoped set of processes are processes where every process has a clear start and a clear end, clear input, clear output. It has a clear and coherent set of objects that it manipulates. Invoices, whether that is an invoice or a purchase order or a quote or any other document, an application in the case of a government permitting process. It has a very clear customer, of course, and it has a clear owner. Yeah, you can put an owner behind it. And in the bottom level process in the hierarchy, the owner is going to be easy to define. And the more you go to the top, the more it's going to be a manager. A game of the manager is not the process owner is not a manager of the process. He's like a politician playing games of influence with other managers. And that's what process management at the top is really about. And if you do this exercise, then you will get something called process architecture, which consists of the following. There are the top level processes that you identify as you go along, because I only did the order to cash here, but there's procure to pay, or there is recruitment, or, you know, there is facilities management, and so on, all sorts of processes there. So you have a bunch of top level processes that are kind of not related to each other, neither through hierarchical relationships, nor through upstream-downstream relations. Those ones are going to be here, and that's going to be called your process landscape, right? Or some people call it a service landscape because they are not yet processes. They are more like services you have to provide. And then you decompose them and you get abstract processes. I will say that in many companies, order to delivery is still very abstract. There's in some cases, the order to deliver is very complex. Take, for example, a company that sells hours, a consultancy company or an IT service provisioning company that sells hours, right? Order to delivery is still quite abstract, because delivery means, you know, getting 10 people to do some job at the customer's premises, and you have to organize them, manage the roster, do all the planning, and so on, and then deliver, test, see if the customer is happy, and then market as delivered. So it's kind of a process, complex process, and you might want to split it into additional sub-process, and then you get to the level of detailed process models. So sometimes one level of decomposition is perhaps enough, but most of the times you need another level of decomposition because the products, process here, like product delivery, are still too big to treat as one. There are maybe several sub-processes. And that's the outcome of process identification, right? But that's not the process enumeration and scoping. But that's not all there is in a process architecture. I want to keep you to keep this in mind. Once you have your processes, you have a process architecture, it is very important that you prioritize these processes in terms of process improvement. Which ones do I start with? Great, I have a process architecture with 40 processes. So what will be my next improvement project? And there, this guy, Tom Davenport, which is one of the gurus of BPM, proposes three criteria for assessing your processes. One is how important the process is to your organization. And that can be tied to revenue. If you started to doing this process so bad that if you started doing the process really, really bad, how much revenue would your company lose? Or how much profit would your company lose? And that would determine the strategic importance of the process to your organization. The second one is how healthy your process is at the moment. Do you think it is actually extremely efficient, extremely functional? Do people involved in the process perceive that it is being done very well? There are very low error rates. It's very efficient. There are very it's delivered on time, very timely. Then you will say it's very functional. If not, you will say it's dysfunctional. So you will rate your process with respect to its potential dysfunction. Its function, or whether it's good or bad, potentially functional or dysfunctional. And the third thing, which is often neglected, is what is the politics behind improving this process, right? If you are here, there is very little politics because there is one sales manager you need to convince, and that's it, right? Yeah. You have a problem with your lead-to-quote processes. I show you the KPIs. I compare them with KPIs in the industry, and you see we are not doing very well. We have a only converting 10% of our leads into quotes. Yeah. And you convince the sales manager, yeah, this is great, you're right, what should we do? And you go on, very little politics. You go here, it's a lot of politics, because now there is many different managers involved in that level of the process. So it's a process that might be difficult to change, and there has to be a strong external driver to change it. So you have to qualify the feasibility of the process. And out of this, you can do something very simple. If you have identified, say, 20 processes, there are 20 dots in there, I hope, then you will try to give a grade, let's say on a scale of 1 to 5, to how feasible it is to change this process, make changes to this process. So this means it's actually quite possible to engage with the people in this process and do a change. And this means this will be really, really difficult to engage in this process. And then you take your other two parameters. Strategic importance, measured in terms of how much revenue does the company stand to lose from doing this process wrong. And dysfunction, which is given, if I put reasonable performance metrics for this process, how well are we performing on these performance metrics? I'll come back to the question of performance metrics in a minute. And then you rank it again, maybe on a scale of 1 to 5 or some other scale. all this importance and this function, and then you will put your each process as a dot and you put it in here in this scale. So here, for example, we see a process that is easy to change, high importance, low dysfunction. No, it's quite functional, very important on the other hand. Small improvement can yield a lot of revenue improvements, and it's easy to change. Whereas here I have a process that is quite important, quite dysfunctional, very bad KPIs, but it is very hard to change. And then you want to say, how do I prioritize? Where do I start? And your proposal is? You probably want to start here, right? We call them implement this quadrant. You want to start with the process that have high importance and not too much politics to change. And you start killing these dogs here, right? And then you have to decide, do you go for low-hanging fruits? These are the low-hanging fruits. Very easy to change this IT service provisioning process. It has low importance, let's say, right? But because it's so easy, maybe we'll pick this one and say, let's do it. Or you are in for a challenge, and you take a process that is dysfunctional, important, but hard to change. There you better have some upper management for that one. And these are the ones that you will never even look at. Kill these ideas. It's hard to change, and it's a low importance process or a completely functional process where, you know, you know, the KPIs, people are very satisfied with the KPIs, right? So, and processes are moving in this here, right? So these dots are moving. You are not seeing it because they are moving so slowly that it doesn't show up in the slides. But they are moving, right? It's never, your pitch chart, beginning of this year, will not look the same as the pitch chart beginning of next year. And this is a basically basic instrument for prioritizing your processes for the purpose of improvement. And now coming to the KPIs, because you have to assess the functionality or the level of dysfunction of your processes. So here's an idea of how to come up with an initial set of KPIs. Let me say, process performance measurement is an art of its own, and most likely the quality management people do it much better than the BPM people. But this is an idea, right? What you want in your business is to do things cheaper, faster, and better. So then you say, so I have a process, it has a clear start, it has a clear end, great. So there's a notion of an execution of this process. Okay? So you will try to see how much every execution of the process is costing us. In other words, how much every fulfillment of an order is costing us. How much are we spending for per purchase order? That's a possible KPI, very often used. Another one is resource utilization. If I take those people who are involved in order to delivery, and how busy are they? You know, how, given the load of orders I receive and the amount of resources they have, you know, how, are they 80% busy? Are they 60% busy? Are they 90% busy? Well, if you ask them, they will always tell you 90%. No, 110. Right? But you can dig in deeper. Or how much unnecessary work are we performing in this process? How many things are we doing there that are not delivering value to the customer? And we'll get to this notion of value. Then there is this this on the cost. I'll tell you, most process performance measures on the cost will fall here, here, or here. Then there's time. So again, you have a clear start and a clear finish. This is a great thing about processes, right? So you can measure how much time there is between the process instance starts and the process finishes. And you can measure it for a lot of instances. And you do an average, and the average amount of time it takes, that's called the cycle time. And you can use that as a KPI. Most often, what counts is not so much from the moment you start to the moment you finish, but the moment in between every two customer interactions. Because if a customer tells, put me a permitting application, right? An application to build something. How much time it takes to deliver the permit is important. But maybe more important is how much time it takes between the moment the customer puts something and the moment I come with the first response to the customer. Like a request for additional information. That's the time I really care to compress, right? Then there is another one which is at the same level and is completely similar to resource utilization, is waiting time, which is how much time, I'm going to put it this way. If I went to ask for a passport and there was one person in the counter who could take my passport application and just go everywhere in the passport office to get my passport done and bring it back to me, how much time that will take? That if a person had the full power to do it, one single person, let's say it will take me 2 hours to get my passport. How much time it actually takes me to get one? 1 week. So 7 days working days minus 5 working days minus 2 hours, that is wait time. This time, every process execution is waiting somewhere in the inbox of someone in the passport office or in the whatever that is. Migración y ya Coda Condus Amet. There you are. I know that one very well. My favorite application, my favorite government agency. And then related to that is no value adding time, which is more than the waiting time. All waiting time is no value adding, but there are, believe it or not, there are some things you do in your process that are not needed. So those are non-value adding, and those ones you can also discount them, and then you get the measure of how much time there is. And this is actually related to waste. The more waste you have, the higher your non-value adding time. And quality. How do you measure quality? So again, I come back to this beautiful thing, is that a process has a start and has an end. And the ends, we call them outcomes, and we enumerate the outcomes. Rainy day methodology, we say, you know, what can go bad? We enumerate the outcomes and we say which are the positive outcomes and which are the negative outcomes. Then we take a bunch of instances of our process and we see how many ended up in positive territory and how many ended up in negative territory. And the ones that end up in negative territory divided by all of them, that's called the error rate. How many times my process ends in a negative outcome. And you can do a bit more sophisticated by giving different weights to different types of errors. Or another pitch on that is if I have a service level agreement that I will deliver at this amount of time and 99.9% of the times it will be like this, then how many violations of my SLA I have, right? That could be another way, typically using IT services. And here you can ask the quality manager, they are much better at it. Customer feedback, right? Net promoter score, what percentage of your customers are willing to recommend you to their friends. The NPS is called, Net Promoter Score, or customer feedback, how much positive impressions you have with your customers divided by the total amount of impressions. And your first reactions, very natural reaction, the first time you start talking about these things, is like, oh, but how do we measure them? Where is the thing? Oh, I see. And you will be surprised at how many times the data to measure all these, it's in your company. You don't have to go and look it elsewhere. It's there, right? And your IT people are sitting on top of it, sometimes without knowing it, right? So most of your companies offers internet sales service, right? Right. Every single one of these systems has something behind called a log. Huge stuff like that. If you are using a nice system, the log is nice. If you are not using a nice system, the log is awful. And that's why the IT people are hiding it from you. And in that log, you can probably find everything to do this, and by virtue of that, this, possibly even this, if you have some little buttons in your interface. Not so much this, because this requires internal information. So you have the data to measure your processes now in your company, just that people are not using it. Yeah. And even for internal processes, you have a document management system, right? Everybody hates it. Right. In this document management system, a lot of the things that are happening are stored. travel requisitions, I don't know, purchase requisitions, all sorts of requisitions, as we call them. Well, that document management system has a log as well, believe it or not. And if you grab that log, it contains, again, everything, most of the things we need to measure these things. So, I mean, measuring how functional the process is, of course, you can do it by means of guessing, guesswork, if you want, but you can also do it with real data, or at least with sampling. You can sample some instances and get some good impression of these measures and measure the dysfunctionality of your processes. I'm going to skip a few things in the interest of going quicker. And when we come back, we will go into process discovery and we'll see how far we get into the rest. Any questions about this part? Identification, prioritization? You are ready to go and discover, scope, and prioritize your processes? Go for it. Thanks.